You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV. Television addict! Television addict!
Television addict! Hey everybody, welcome. It's time for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed, your TV Guidance Counselor, here each and every week as you are, and I thank you very much for it. That is a weird noise in the background. That is my scanner. I do scan some ads from old TV guides. I don't want to brag too much. I don't want to get the ladies too excited, but that is what happens. My guest this week, this is a very, very exciting episode. If you're a regular listener of the show, you know how much I love Mr. Belvedere. Bryce Beckham, who was Wesley on the show, has guested before. Well, my guest this week is Tracy Tofte. That is her current name. You probably best know her as Tracy Wells, who played Heather on Mr. Belvedere. And I was able to grab some of her time thanks to a listener of the show. She was actually a request to guest on the show through a listener, and they contacted her first and put her in touch with me, and I thank them because this was a very, very fun conversation. She is now in real estate, and we discussed that here. Very interesting. I love talking to her. I think you will enjoy hearing me talk to her. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Tracy Wells.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me.
Tracy, how are you?
I'm doing great. How are you?
Good. Thank you so much for trekking out here.
Of course.
Although you did get to scratch your professional curiosity by looking at the property.
I did. This is an amazing property.
Do you normally, is this like an area that you would normally?
Absolutely. Okay. I've sold and helped people buy properties in Burbank and all over the San Fernando Valley. I grew up in the San Fernando Valley,
yeah,
so I know it. Yeah, I know it really well. So.
Yeah, it's, I love the valley. Like, everyone kind of makes fun of it, but I'm like, no, it's the thing I realized was every show I watched growing up, their like vision of America was here. So it feels really comfortable.
Yeah. They don't really talk about the traffic involved on those TV shows, but yeah, there's a lot of traffic in the valley. In fact, it just feels like more and more and more people are living in the valley, but there's so much history. So many great restaurants and stores, and it just has a great vibe to it. You can drive a couple blocks and it can be totally different.
Yeah. Oh, totally.
And that's what I like about it.
I mean, even like I'm big on like the first few times I came out, I'd go to like, oh, they shot him. This is the house from that movie kind of thing.
Yeah.
And right off Sunset on one of those little suburban side streets, it's like the house from Nightmare on Elm Street. And then like the houses from Halloween. And it feels like some Midwestern suburban town.
Exactly.
And then you walk to Hollywood Boulevard.
Exactly.
It's like very weird. Were you the only person in the industry in your family? Or?
No, my sister, actually, we both were. My sister did a lot of stuff. She was in the remake of the movie, The Bad Seed.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
She was the bad seed.
Oh, right. It was a TV movie, right?
Yeah, it was a TV movie with David Carradine.
Oh, yeah, and Patty McCormick played the mom in that one, I think, instead of the kid.
I believe so. Yeah, don't quote me on that, but I believe so. But yeah, my sister was in that. She did like Highway to Heaven and St. Elsewhere and a bunch of different stuff. So we both, our mom was pretty much devoted stage mom.
Right.
To my sister and I, driving us to auditions everywhere.
So was that driven by you guys? You're like, we want to do this?
Yeah.
Because everyone I know who grew up out here, they just know kids who do it. Because it's,
so it's like, everywhere.
Oh, yeah.
People come out here just for pilot season.
Yeah.
It's like they don't even live out here, but they're living out here because of pilot season. It's like the place to be. But yeah, my mom never forced us. We both, my sister and I both, were really, really in love with being in the business.
Do you remember what made you want to do it? Was there like a specific thing you wanted to do, or you like saw something and you were like, oh, I want to do that? Or was it just your sister doing it?
You know what? I don't think so. I don't remember who started first because I'm the older sister. But we were both very much into dancing. We did a lot of dance classes. And my dance teacher just said to my mom, you really should get your daughters into the business. So my mom thought, what the heck? Let's try this. And got us an agent. And my first year, I did 17 national commercials.
Wow.
Yeah, I just, like, I loved it. I ate it all up. Like, they asked you to do stuff on camera. Didn't matter, like, how much of an idiot I looked like. I was, like, I was doing it. And, you know, I just, like, both feet in 100%.
Do you remember your favorite commercial from that era?
One of the commercials that I really enjoyed doing was the Michael Jackson Pepsi commercial.
Oh, that, the commercial.
The commercial. Well, it was with Alfonso Ribeiro. So yep. It's not the one where he caught his hair on fire. Right, but
which
one,
didn't
air. Right. Yeah. But it was the one with Alfonso Ribeiro, and that was so much fun because we got to film it on the big lot over here at Universal, and it was just a blast.
Yeah.
Was it Universal or Warner Brothers? I don't remember, but it was just so much fun. So much fun.
Did you get starstruck as a kid at that age, though?
Oh, God, yeah.
Okay. Because it's always either like the extreme of they're like, oh, no, whatever.
Or oh, yeah.
Like, what?
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, even when I'd see people, because we were on ABC, Belvedere was on ABC, when we would see other ABC shows, because oftentimes they'd have all the ABC shows get together and do like a publicity thing. Like one year we had to do a video and they filmed us dancing in the streets. And it was to the song Dancing in the Streets. And like Alyssa Milano was there and the kids from Growing Pains and everything. And
it's for the upfronts usually or something.
Yeah, like that, and you just feel like, oh my God, that's so-and-so from that show. I mean, they're just like, we're all the same.
Right.
But it's just really cool to see them, and everyone was really nice.
I guess it would you could feel easily disconnected from them because you're sort of co-workers who work for the same company. But yeah, you wouldn't necessarily
Exactly. You don't hang out and do stuff together. I guest starred on Growing Pains, so yep. I got to know everybody then. But for the most part, you all kind of know each other. Like, oh, I know who that is, but you don't really know each other.
Right, because it is a pretty small group of people, like especially in that era, there was like maybe 20-ish kids, like core kids that were in all the stuff.
Yeah.
Did you ever do, one of the things that fascinates me are those like weird contractual, like made-for-TV movies they would make all the teen actors do, once every summer?
You know what? I didn't do one of those, but I did after-school specials. I was in a couple after-school specials with other kids that were also on TV and... You know, it's like, I think I did one with Dana Barron and Chad Lowe. Lori Loughlin was in it.
Oh, that's
No Means No.
Yeah.
No Means No. So
those things were huge. Like, and it's sort of a
You don't realize until you look back what a big deal those were. Yeah. When you did them, it was just like, it's an after school special. But yeah, they were kind of cool. It's like a time in history that those things, you know, you don't see those anymore.
No, and I wonder if it's because things are better and you don't need them.
I actually think it's worse. special about drugs,
yeah,
you know,
absolutely. But it's that kind of segues nicely into like one of the things about Belvedere that like ends up we talk about a lot on the show is it had a lot of like the very special episodes.
Yes,
but. It's funny because you had people from like KRP or like Barney Miller running the show.
Yeah.
And they're, you know, two generations above and they're kind of sincerely trying to
be hip
and also like helpful. But they're also like, I'm a sitcom writer, so I'm going to put these jokes in it. And like the tone is really hard to balance.
Correct.
Which was probably the case when you were doing it, I imagine.
Yeah, I think that's why there was a lot of people that were huge fans of the show. And I think there were some people that just felt like, it was kind of shticky, kind of cheesy, because it was trying to be one thing, but then also bring in the undertones of serious subjects.
Yeah.
Like, you know, we did an episode about a kid that was HIV positive, and then they did an episode around my character about date rape.
Yep.
You know, they were always trying to bring in those things because I guess they kind of did well in ratings and just...
Was that the motivation, do you think? Or?
I'm not 100% sure,
but...
It definitely, every year there was one or two episodes we did that were a very special episode.
Right. And with that, would you kind of dread that? Or was it like, oh, we know we're going to do one of these this year. You're like, what is it going to be? Because it's sort of breakneck where you'll have like a fairly wacky episode. And then the next week it's like, you know, the camp one.
Right.
Or, you know, and then the next week it's like, we're putting on a play. You know?
I guess it's just one of those things where it's like, when we heard in advance what the episode was going to be about, my first thought was, how is that a comedy?
Right. Right.
Like, why are we doing that? That has nothing to do with comedy.
But even like the Wesley's Friend episode with the HIV kid, like the first introduction is on a gag. Like he comes in and Euchre's like, how you doing, champ, or something?
Yeah.
And he's like, well, I got AIDS, but other than that, I'm doing pretty good.
Yeah.
And it's like,
Today, that wouldn't be so funny.
No, but it is funny when I try to explain to like younger people like the intent and the context of it.
Yeah.
Where I'm like, families watch things together.
They do.
So it was a way to like kind of truly broadcast to everybody.
I think the audience today is so much more mature and evolved. Back then, it's kind of like we were like kind of putting our pinky toe in the water and seeing what ripple effect it would have.
Right.
Whereas today, we don't have those types of sitcoms anymore. But if there was today, I don't think it would be structured that way. I think it would be rip the Band-Aid off and like full board head. Get into it.
Yeah.
Because it's like, for example, reality TV these days, that wasn't even a thing back then. So you can't like pull the wool over people's eyes anymore.
Yeah, I guess it is harder to like soft shoe into a thing. Yeah, because you had maybe American Family, was it by then? And with the Loud Family, that PBS documentary, if you remember that.
Yeah, I don't remember that.
That was kind of the first reality show. And it, you know, they had like a gay son. And did you ever see Albert Brooks's Real Life?
Mm-mm.
Oh, it's like, might be his first movie, but it's like a parody of that from like 75, which is really weird.
Yeah.
Were you watching a lot of stuff as a kid before you started going out for things?
Yeah, I would watch TV. I was really into music, listening to music, watching TV. But a lot of my childhood after school was going to dance class.
Right.
That was a lot of it. And then when we would get home, my sister and I would have to practice our dance or practice our singing. We were always working on our performance and working on our skills.
Is there a thing that you've done? Because you did do some singing and dancing in episodes of Mr. Mm-hmm. Belvedere. Is there a thing that you have done that you thought was like best represented what you could do in that? Did you ever get to do what you would want to have done?
For dancing?
Yeah, or singing or any of the stuff that you...
Well, first of all, I don't think I'm a good singer. Okay. And my sister disagrees with that. But she's the singer. She can definitely sing. Dancing-wise... not really. I mean, I did dancing in the Pepsi commercial and on a bunch of episodes on Belvedere. And then I did dancing in this really cheesy, low budget movie called The Raven Dance.
Okay.
And I did a ton of dancing in that. So I loved the fact that I got to do that because I studied really hard and worked really hard at it. So the fact that I could do that, but that wasn't my main focus. My main focus was acting.
Okay. So once you got into it via dancing, but once you started kind of doing the acting,
exactly.
You're like, this is what it is.
Exactly.
Were you in Gremlins? Was that like one of the first things?
One of the first things I did was Gremlins, and I had a lot more lines than what actually ended up in the movie. That's the second time that happened to me, actually. My mom and I went to the movie premiere for Best Little Whorehouse in Texas.
Oh, yeah.
And I had a few lines in that. And I was, this is before Belvedere. So like getting a few lines in a movie was like a big deal.
And that was what, Burt Reynolds and Dolly Parton?
Yeah.
I mean, that's a big movie.
It is a big movie. So we went to the premiere and my mom and I are so excited. And it was like, you blinked and that was it. And you're thinking, are they coming back to my scene?
Right.
Like, are the lines still coming? They're not coming, are they? So that was just, you know, you learn very quickly as a kid that just because you get something and you get hired to do the job doesn't mean that it's going to be there in the final cut. So the same thing happened with Gremlins. Went to the movie premiere and the same exact thing happened. But still, to be able to put it on my resume and go through the audition process and get it feels really good.
Yeah, especially with like a big movie like that, like movie like those movies, which are being cast by like top people. So
huge,
like,
people and directors that we got to work with. So
do you remember anything from the set on that? Like, was it, were you scared? Like, were they, because I know there was a lot of like weird turmoil on the set of Gremlins.
Well, on Gremlins, all I remember was is it was really hard to breathe because in all of our scenes, I don't remember what the stuff's called, but they push down this handle and it puffs out all this kind of smoke stuff that makes it all filtery.
Yeah.
And the stuff smells really, really bad. And it was super, super hot. I just remember being like a little bit uncomfortable. But in terms of the drama that was going on, we weren't really a part of that.
Yeah.
You know, I got to work with a great, you know, great director there, Joe Dante, and then getting to work with Herbert Ross on Pennies from Heaven. Yep. I got to dance in that. So working with him and then directors on Annie and Best Little Whorehouse in Texas, I mean, to say that I got to have that experience on a big movie production was really, really cool, even though I was just a little speck.
But still, like, I had Katie McLean on. I don't know if you know Katie.
She's, oh, I totally know Katie. Yes.
And it was one of the first few things, and it's like you got to participate in a tiny way, but in this sort of the tail end of, like, old Hollywood. That was, like, really one of the last things like that.
Yes. Oh, my gosh. Katie McLean. Yeah. That brings back memories because we hung out all the time on the set, and we just absolutely, like, lost touch. And then, you know, she got big on, on the soap opera.
I'd be happy to reintroduce you.
Oh, that would be amazing.
She just directed a movie, a documentary about women directors.
Oh, wow.
With, like, Joanna Kearns. And,
oh, wow. Good for her.
Yeah. So, but she was like, oh, because I always ask, like, some people are people who keep mementos from from things they've done.
Mm-hmm.
And the one thing she kept is when all the pennies, mm-hmm. she has like a jar of them.
Oh, wow.
Because the prop guy was like, yeah, I don't know, you can do it.
I don't need them. You take them.
Yeah. Did you keep it? Did you get anything that you have like still from those days? Like even from the commercials, sometimes you'd get stuff.
When I did the Pepsi commercial, Michael Jackson signed like a bunch of pictures for us.
Oh, wow.
And then I got a ton of stuff from Belvedere. Yeah, I've got stuff from that.
You still have that stuff?
I do somewhere. I should find it. But yeah, I do. Somewhere tucked away.
Like the crew gifts and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, like the crew gifts and scripts, like the last script everybody signed and stuff like that.
Did you watch the show?
That's a great question. I did not watch it religiously, and I think I'm just really critical of myself, so it's really hard.
The case.
Yeah, it's like really hard to watch. But the cast got together not too long ago, and we did a retrospective, and we all did like commentary on it.
Right.
And so we had to watch the episodes together as a group, and it's just like, wow, I remember that. I remember that. Oh my gosh, look at how young we all were. It's just kind of crazy looking back at it. And then years later, I said to my kids, like, you know, because where our TV is, above it is like a bunch of DVDs. And I said, oh, we should watch this. It's all the Mr. Belvedere episodes. And they're like, yeah, no.
Yeah, kids are never interested in her, which is hilarious because that would seem... Growing up in Boston when nobody's done anything cool, like we had Spencer for Hire, speaking of ABC, which shot in Boston. But like if your parent was on a TV show, they'd be like, yes. And every single person I know here with kids, they're like, all right, whatever, lame. Like they just do not care
to
watch anything.
No.
But that show was huge. I mean, it was for what, 5 seasons?
Six.
That was an enormous show. It was an anchor show.
It was.
And it became like a cultural touchstone. Like it would be referenced in things and that sort of stuff. And living out here where that's kind of normal, I guess, or people aren't as, don't react as extremely to that stuff.
Right, because they're kind of numb to it.
Yeah.
Because this is where everybody knows somebody in the movie industry.
So did that trickle down to you? Like, did you get a sense of that at the time, or was it just kind of like you're just working and kind of have no idea?
No, there were times where I would get recognized. Like sometimes it was hard to go certain places, and even if I don't look the way I looked on TV, as soon as I started talking, my voice, kind of gives it away. But even today, and it doesn't happen very often, when people recognize me, I'm very grateful because it opened up so many opportunities for me in my life.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that not a lot of people get that opportunity. There's thousands upon thousands of people trying to get that opportunity.
Yeah.
And I was really blessed to get that opportunity. So I don't take it for granted.
Right, which is great. Like, and one of the really eye-opening and so also like very nice things I've come to the realization of since doing the show and talking to so many people that about things is almost everybody is like that, at least that I've talked to, which is like, you know, a few hundred people.
Right.
And you wouldn't think that, but it's just like it's a fairly blue collar job that you got to hustle and has a really high profile, and they don't take for granted what it was.
No. And the other thing is as quickly as you can get it, it can also be taken away as quickly. Right. And if you take a break from it and you try to get back into it, it's not easy.
Right.
So when you have it, you need to soak it up and enjoy it because you never know when it's going to end.
It's not going to be like this forever.
Yeah, and that's just the hard truth.
Which happened with Belvedere, right? Like, you get, like, the first, last two episodes didn't really even air for a while.
Yeah, kinda, it was just kind of, ABC just kind of lost its interest, and it got played a little bit late, and then it just kind of fizzled out. Yeah, just kind of fizzled out.
Was that shocking, or were you kind of, did you kind of have a sense of, like, oh, it's probably kind of on the downside?
You kind of know when you're in your last season, and then you kind of feel when you're not the darling anymore.
Right, right.
You just have that sense. Even at the age I was at, I could sense that.
Right. Did you immediately want to try to get another sitcom, or were you like, got it out of my system, did that, or were you just like, I don't know what to do now?
I just wanted to work.
Yeah.
I just wanted to work. So I did a few things after Belvedere, but I have to say it was really hard to get work.
Was it hard because people knew you too well from that show? Like, they're almost like, oh, you're the...
Some of the feedback I would get was, oh, that wasn't a hit show. So it's like, well, what does that have to do with what I can do now? Well, right. I already know what she can do on the show, but she's able to do other things.
Yeah.
So you just kind of get typecast into it. So when I started, like, for example, there was a TV sitcom. It was a pilot, actually, from the creators of Friends. Mm-hmm. And they brought me back like 13 times, just callback after callback after callback. It was so brutal. And I thought for sure that I had it.
Yeah.
And then they brought in another actress to read, and she ended up getting it, Hilary Swank.
Oh, yeah.
And then at that point, I was like, I'm done. I'm out. I need a break.
It's so, it's, and I get this with stand-up to a degree, but not nearly like it is with acting. But the thing that I pick up that's so frustrating is you can have a fantastic resume and all the skills in the world, and at the end of the day, like, you kind of have no control over it because it could just be like, well, you look too much like my sister and it weirds me out.
Yes.
Or like, you know, and I always say that.
you remind me of my ex.
Right. Yeah. Or that, or like, you would never go to an office job and like, resume's great. I don't think you look right.
Right. I mean, exactly.
Which is how it is here. And yep. that is tough at any age. I imagine, especially when you're like a teenager or a young person, that's mm-hmm. like a really hard, really hard lesson.
It is, you know, especially when, because I wasn't exactly going on the auditions for the gorgeous lead or the gorgeous girlfriend. It was usually the best friend or something like that. So, you know, you just learn to kind of suck it up and go, okay, it is what it is.
Right. It's what
and
I
I'm
do.
Gonna, yeah, and I'm just gonna go in there and do the best that I can. So I got cast after Belvedere in quite a few things where I was the best friend, but I mean, I was getting paid, I was getting, you know, some notoriety, it was good publicity. I had a publicist. I mean, it was like the fact that I was just working after Belvedere, I was grateful for.
Did you have like a natural inclination for comedy stuff?
Or? Actually, the other way around.
Really?
Yeah.
Because you are very funny on Belvedere.
Oh, thank you.
But that was hard for you? Or?
It wasn't hard. I just think that the drama stuff just seemed to come a little bit easier for me. The comedy for me... On other shows, it's all about the timing and how it's written and who you're playing against. Mm-hmm. So sometimes the Belvedere stuff just after a while was...
Chemistry between you.
Yeah, it was just me. And it was usually Bryce and I.
Yeah.
And which was fine. We played really well off of each other. But after a while, after six seasons, you're just kind of striving for something else.
Yeah, the sort of thrill is gone. Yeah. That thing. Yeah, absolutely.
No offense, Bryce.
Yeah. No, we know Bryce, and that is his fault.
Hardly.
But also, like, I imagine you were getting a lot of, like, teen magazine attention and, like, all that kind of stuff. Like, I remember I had Laura Jo Miller on, and she was like, yeah, they would set up, like, press things to have in the teen magazine that was like a total fake whatever.
Yeah.
And everyone kind of just knew, but people were like, oh, wow.
Yeah. I had a 16th birthday party on the ABC lot, and a bunch of people were invited, some that I didn't invite, but they knew it would be a good publicity. So, you know, the photographers are there taking your picture with certain people, kissing you on the cheek and wishing you a happy birthday. And yeah, you get used to that, and you start to understand that that's kind of what it's all about.
But that's an extra weird one where you're having like a personal human event, like your birthday.
Yeah.
But you have to recognize that there are going to be certain aspects of it today that will be like a facade of this, and then the real party is just like in here at the same time.
That's pretty much the whole industry, though.
True. Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty much how it is. Because, yeah, it's really true. You have this birthday party, this big birthday party. You're turning 16, have the people you don't know, but you're like, wow, this is really cool. There's these celebrities here, and it's a lot of fun. But you're just kind of walking through this maze, especially at 16 years old. You know, my mom, when I was 16 years old, my mom had passed away I was 15 and three quarters. She passed away 2 months before my 16th birthday. And, you know, navigating through all of that without an adult is just different. So learning like who your friends are, who you can trust, that's a big deal.
Yeah. Oh, I can't even imagine. Like,
and I think kids today are a lot more mature than we were back then. And again, because of everything with social media and TV. Right. So like back then, you're just kind of like, you truly are what a 16-year-old is.
Yeah.
Whereas a 16-year-old today is like a 30-year-old.
Yeah. They're much savvier.
Yes.
They tend to have more of a, they suss that stuff out a little bit better.
Absolutely.
Their intuition's a little bit better, maybe. Their judgment may not be, but their intuition is. At least know that it's, you know, something's weird.
Uh-huh.
And without an adult to kind of guide you for that stuff, if you don't have that, that's got to be scary.
Yeah.
Like did you ever get asked to do, like Circus of the Stars or anything like that?
I was asked to do Circus of the Stars and I said no.
Yeah, because that seems like totally different thing, but it made me think of it where it's
That was a big deal back then. Circus of the Stars, and there was something else, I can't remember what it was called, but it was on NBC and there was like all these sporting events.
The Battle of the Networks.
That's it.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They had different teams for each network.
Yes.
And you weirdly got paid more if you won. So they really wanted people to like really try and put up with getting.
I am not athletic at all.
No, I would not have a good time with that. It wouldn't even be worth the comedic value of it. Was there anything like that, like anything extracurricular outside of the show that you enjoyed doing, like any of the publicity stuff or a show that you got to appear on?
I once guested on the Tonight Show.
Oh, wow.
And it was when Jay Leno was doing Monday nights.
Okay,
he was only hosting on Monday nights. So I did that. And that was, so when you audition for that, this is a funny story. When I auditioned for that, it's not even that you audition. I think they bring in people that they're like, how would she do in a setting where she's sitting there talking to the host?
The pre-interview.
Correct.
Yeah.
So they brought me in and I was interviewed by a gentleman. I don't remember his name, but I'm sure he's some big producer guy for the show.
Right.
And he brought me in and I just would not shut up. Yeah. I just kept talking. And he was laughing and thought I was hysterical. And I mean, I was like, back then, I would go into situations where I felt like I had nothing to lose. Like, what do I got to lose? Right. I don't have it, so I got nothing to lose. So I'm just going to, like, you know, basically balls to the walls and just give it my all and see what happens. So I did. I gave a really good interview. And then he booked me on the show with Jay Leno. But when you get out there, it is a whole different world.
Yeah.
A whole different world.
Yeah.
And as much as people said, you did great, you were fantastic, in my heart, I felt like the nerves got the best of me.
Yeah.
Because doing that is so different. It's really no different than what we're doing now.
Well,
however, there's like a gazillion people in the audience and the band and you know what
and
I mean?
The crew, and you're like, I don't want to waste their time. Like, what's going on?
Yeah,
it's
like,
very deer in the headlights.
It's very deer in the headlights. In fact, so much so you can't even see anything because there's so much lights and cameras pointing at you and you're just looking at Jay Leno and then you're just afraid like, please don't say something like that I'm not going to know how to respond to or be funny enough. So,
Yeah. It's it makes you realize that like classic honeymooners, hummina game show episode where like every sitcom had an episode where some reason the family was on a game show, which I think even you guys did. Maybe.
I don't think we were on a game show, but Eileen Graff, who played our mom, she was the queen of game shows. She did so well on those. Yeah.
She did a great unsold pilot that they burned off in the summer once with Will Wheaton.
Oh, wow.
Called 1313 something Avenue, and it was about an apartment building of like monsters. And she played a witch, and like the handyman, like the super, was like a like an Igor. And like,
oh my god!
And Will Wheaton moves in with like a single mom, and he's just like a regular kid, and they're all like, "We're vampires, you know, monsters." It was super weird. It was like the year before Belvedere, which is kind of nice that it didn't go, because then she would.
Yeah, she's probably like really thankful.
Yeah.
When I auditioned for Belvedere, when we went to network, there were probably like 10 ladies auditioning for the mom, 10 of us auditioning for Heather. I mean, there were small groups of every single character, and they were mixing and matching. And I remember Patricia Heaton was there.
Oh, wow, yeah.
And a couple other actresses, and just people that you just recognize their face, and then they went on to do other things.
Because I think Patricia Heaton got Double Trouble that year instead.
What was the name of the actress that was on Home Improvement?
Oh, that's the one that was in Double Trouble. She was the wife on Home Improvement.
Okay.
It's not Patricia Heaton.
It's not Patricia Heaton, but Patricia Heaton was there. She went on to do eventually Raymond. Everybody Loves Raymond.
No, I know the woman. That's what I'm thinking of, that woman.
Yeah.
But they look vaguely similar.
Yeah, so anyway, that lady was there. She's a fantastic actress. And so it's just kind of funny, like, seeing that.
Were there like other teen actors that were like, if you were going to audition, you're like, oh, these people are going to be there.
Absolutely.
It's like always, you don't have to name them, but it's always like the same person. Like everyone I talk to, it's always like, well, there was like three of them. And one of them, if they were there, I was just like, I'm leaving, not getting this.
Yeah.
And then there were other ones where I was like, oh, I got this.
I would say yes and no to both, because I would see the same people for commercial auditions as I would for theatrical stuff. Mm-hmm. And I would say we all pretty much rotated. We all got our shot. Kind of like me in real estate. I truly believe there's enough business out there for everybody. You just have to do a good job.
Right.
Be good at what you do.
And it'll find the niche that you should
exactly.
be
fitting. Yeah. Exactly. But yeah, especially like when I was doing auditions for dance, it was always the same group of people. And I actually think that kind of should give you confidence. Like, I'm actually good because I keep running into the same people. It keeps coming down to the wire of us. So we're kind of like,
we're the group.
Yep. Yep.
And also, like, I imagine there was a bunch of dance shows at that time because Fame was so huge.
Mm-hmm.
And there was also, like, what was the one that Lorenzo Lamas hosted? It was called, like, it was like a Solid Gold ripoff.
I don't
know. It was
know.
Like a mixture of Solid Gold and Dance Fever.
Oh,
and
wow.
It was just bizarre. It was fantastic. Were you ever asked to host anything like that? Like, it was NBC, so we wouldn't have done like Friday Night Videos, but mm-hmm. they would always have like the teen actors from the shows like mm-hmm. host like the Saturday morning preview or like that kind of stuff.
Mm-mm.
Would you have wanted to do that? It sounds like it would have been kind of like, huh?
Maybe. I don't know. I wasn't ever asked to host anything like that. So I don't really know.
Do you have a favorite episode that either you think is the best for your character, the best work that you did, or just like you fondly remember or sticks out to you?
I do remember there was an episode. It was actually the very special episode of the date rape episode.
Yep.
Where the guy that I was taking me to prom, like, you know, made a move towards me and I had to fight him off of me. They didn't show that part. It's only discussed.
But you go back with like your dress is torn. Or
yes.
Something.
Yeah. And there was a scene in the backyard with Belvedere on the back porch. That's usually where the very serious conversations happened. And I remember us filming it and being afraid to cry.
Mm-hmm.
I was almost like afraid to cry because it felt like it wasn't the time or the place. Like I was supposed to hold it together. And then the director came out because we had filmed it a few different takes. And he had come up to me. I don't remember what he said to me, but whatever he said to me, we did the take, and that's the take that's in the episode where I just can't stop crying.
Yeah.
And it was just like the tears were like coming down my face. And I just remember thinking how letting your guard down when you're acting isn't such a bad thing.
Right.
Because I had done Belvedere for so long, and doing a scene, a serious scene like that, where you're actually getting in touch with your emotions, was something a little foreign to me, because mm-hmm. that's not something we did on a day-to-day basis.
You'd get a lot of laugh lines, like correct. The room line.
Correct. Yeah. So that was, I definitely remember that very well. And then when we filmed the final episode, I think I was the only one that cried in that last scene. when I said goodbye to Belvedere.
Yeah, because you knew that was the last episode, too.
Yeah, right? It was the last episode, and I was really sad, and it was like, I could feel it, you know, and it's like coming up your neck, and you can feel it in your gland.
No. You know,
I was like, oh my God, but this is it. This is our last time we're all going to be together. And it really felt like I was saying goodbye to him.
Which is, in hindsight, when you get older, 6 years doesn't seem like that long.
Mm-hmm.
But
in sitcom land?
In sitcom land, that's like you went to like four different full high school cycles with these people. You know what I mean?
It's true. I mean, you grow up so much. And then, you know, I grew up on the set with them. I started when we did the pilot, I turned 12 years old while we were filming the pilot. And when it finally ended, I was 18. I lost my mom during that time. Right. You know, I learned how to drive. I was driving myself, to set. I had bought a house when I was 15 years old. I was emancipated. Yeah. I mean, so much happened in that short amount of time, whereas most kids that it doesn't happen like that.
Right. And it's weird that one of the reasons time goes by exponentially faster when you're older is because things are kind of the same. Like you have less major life events.
Mm-hmm.
So having even more than a person normally does at that time must just feel it. Every year feels like 10.
Yeah.
You know?
Absolutely.
Did you, because that's prime, you know, high school years.
Yeah.
And I assume you're getting set education, or were you going to school? Or?
No. I was getting tutored on the set with Bryce.
Right.
And I've said this before, it's really hard to get a studio teacher that can excel in every subject with two very vastly different ages.
Yeah.
So we would get the schoolwork from my school. But again, there's no one there teaching you the lessons.
Right.
They're just giving you the schoolwork.
Right.
So that made it difficult. I went on the hiatuses and stuff like that. And when we weren't filming, I went to like a performing arts school for kids in the industry. And it was off of Sherman Way. We didn't do... And I don't know if I can cuss here.
Oh, you can absolutely, yes. In fact, it's encouraged.
We didn't do shit there.
Yeah, of course not.
We all just kind of stood around and joked around and sang and danced and walked down to 7-Eleven.
Yeah.
So I didn't get a very good education growing up in the industry. I don't know about kids today.
Yeah.
But back then, it wasn't regulated.
Yeah.
The only thing that was regulated was the amount of hours you had to book while doing your education.
Right. They were just checking a box off. So
correct.
Like, you couldn't, you know, get sued or something.
Correct.
Do you feel like you missed out on anything? Like, I mean, it sounds like a bit of an education a little, but like social stuff, like you can go to like a prom or like that sort of stuff.
I was invited to someone else's prom and I went and I just felt like so out of place.
Right, like so much older than everybody? Cause
older and just the whole, I miss the whole social aspect of going to high school.
Right.
Which I think still affects me today. Like going to big parties and stuff, it's like I get really quiet.
Yeah.
It's not really my thing. And
well,
I wonder.
I went to high school and I'm the same way.
I just wonder sometimes, like going to a regular high school, you know, going to football games and the baseball games and all that other stuff, I kind of missed out on that. But I wouldn't trade any of that in because of what I got to experience. But then my kids, you know, I have two kids. I have a son who's 19, he goes to USC, and a daughter who is 22, and she's graduating this year from UC Berkeley. They went to high school. They had the normal high school life. And I'm really, really happy that they got to experience that.
Right.
And all those experiences that came with it.
And they had zero interest in acting or being in the industry.
Zero interest. Well, I should say this. When my daughter was born, she was my first child. She was so cute and adorable. I was like, I'm going to get her an agent, which is so stupid. And we got her an agent. And then we went on our first audition. And it was for the Michelin tires.
Oh, the baby. They'd put the baby in the middle of the tire.
Yeah, but the only way they would hire your baby was if your baby could. So they had a man dressed in like a blue suit.
Because
like,
he'd be the Michelin tire. It looks like the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man.
Exactly. And the baby couldn't cry. The baby had to be okay with some strange man covered. Yeah. So basically, my daughter was like, hell no.
Yeah. Which you're like, this is good. She has a good sense of danger.
She does.
She's not just like, oh, this seems okay.
She does. So we did a few auditions, but it just wasn't her thing. And then that was it. And my son loves the movie industry. their dad was in the movie industry. Mm-hmm. He was a director photographer. Well, he started out as a cameraman and then a camera operator and then DP. Mm-hmm. And his brother was the same thing in the movie industry. So they grew up around the movie industry.
Right.
So my son was more interested in behind the scenes, but he decided that he wanted to go into engineering, which I'm really happy about because getting into the film industry is not easy.
It's a curse, sort of. Like
sometimes
there are, you know, and I'm so much lower on the experience scale of these things than yourself or people that I know. But you sort of curse your interests or your talents sometimes, where you're like, I mean, I'm good at this is what I do, but also like, ugh, I'm stuck with this kind of thing. It's like I sometimes describe it as like being a werewolf. You're like, lock me up, I'm going to do it. You know, like, I'm going to go act. Where it's not all good, it's not all bad. It's like a weird, you have a weird relationship with it.
It is weird relationship. And then you attribute a lot of your success, whether or not you get booked on things and make money.
Right.
So you could be the most talented werewolf.
Yeah.
But if you're not getting hired, you think you're nothing.
It's hard to get validation in that there's no rhyme or reason to the validation.
Right.
In that if you're an engineer and you design something and it's great, it's going to get made and it's great.
Yes.
If you do a great job, like we said earlier, they might be like, oh, I don't like your hair.
Right. Exactly.
Like, well, what? How is that my fault? When your kids were going to school, did you have trouble relating to like if they had like high school problems or things like that? Because you were like, oh, I don't know. I didn't do that.
No, I didn't have trouble relating. It was more like, what? That goes on in high school?
Right.
You know, it's more like I just didn't know.
Right.
Because I had nothing to relate it to.
Right.
At all.
Right.
Whereas I think a lot of parents today, they're like, oh, yeah, we used to do that, but it was pot. Now it's, you know, God only knows what it is, like heroin.
Heroin, yeah.
So I don't have any of that to relate to.
Right. Right. Because this is instantly what I thought of, which is there's sort of an irony in that, like the show you're doing, especially like the very special episodes and those things, are sort of to teach kids who haven't experienced those sorts of things, like how to, when they encounter them.
Yeah.
But as a result of being in that, you don't have that
experience. You need to go to YouTube. I need to find a very special episode on how to handle high school drugs.
High school friends. Yeah. is there anything that you wished you had gotten that you didn't, that you're like, man, that would have been the dream part? Some people don't have any. They're like, I'm happy with everything that I, you know, wasn't meant to be here.
I think if anything, I wish that I would have gotten another sitcom.
Mm-hmm.
Only because that feeling of the feedback of, well, she was on that sitcom and it wasn't very good. Just to be able to get on another sitcom, I think, was a way to prove that it doesn't have to be. I didn't just get lucky with Mr. Belvedere, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, I can do that. Like, I can do this and I'm good at it.
Yep.
And it's not a fluke.
Yeah. And honestly, I really believe if I didn't quit, because I quit, I made the choice to quit.
Right.
After the whole Hilary Swank thing, I was like, I'm done. I'm over this.
It's, which I can't blame you for. It's brutal.
But if I had stuck it out, when I looking back, you see it so much clearer. I mean, I was getting close on so many things and I was booking things.
Right.
So you never know how that would have played out.
Right. Yeah. I always think it's like Plinko on Price is Right. It just kind of bounces down. You don't know where it's going to land.
Yeah, exactly.
You can't anticipate it. But, and I imagine too, like you did some guest roles either towards the tail end of Belvedere or after.
Mm-hmm.
And it was probably kind of shocking, like the dynamic, because when you're in the main cast, you guys, it's sort of like a family.
Right.
And when you go into an ensemble that's been doing the show for years as a guest actor, even if they're nice, you do not feel a part of the show.
No, you don't at all. In fact, you feel like more like a day actor.
Yeah.
Like when I guest starred on Growing Pains, super great cast and crew. Everyone was super nice, very friendly, very welcoming. But you kind of feel like as you're getting down to the last day, they're already thinking about next week.
Yeah.
And you're like, you're nobody.
Yeah. You're like, oh no, you're not going to come to the office.
But again, that's just the nature of the beast. That's just how the industry was. And I'm assuming probably still is today.
Yeah. It's feast or famine. It's really strange to be sort of close with a group of people for a short or even a longer amount of time, and it's fairly intimate when you're acting, you know. And I don't mean that in like a bedroom connotation, but it's like you're sharing emotions and intimacy of working on these characters.
Yeah.
And then it's just nothing. The next day it's like,
I will tell you, the cast minus Belvedere, who passed away, but we are all still really close. In fact, Eileen just sang. She's got a great voice. She just sang with her daughter, Nika, at Vitello's over here in Studio City. And we all came out to see her.
Oh, that's great.
And some of the crew came out too. So we're still really, really close. And a few years back, she had a Belvedere reunion party where she invited like the entire cast and crew to her house. It was so much fun. I mean, it was just, there is like a true sense of family there. And to be able to see those people and go back and remember, like, wow, it makes the amount of rejection that you had to deal with a lot more palpable. Is that the word?
Yeah.
Because you're just like, you know what? I had so many great memories. And
that's sort of the ideal experience people have with high school that not everyone has that even got to go, but it's, you have this shared experience with a group of people and kind of no one else would get, would understand. And so you have this link that you'll always have.
Absolutely.
And I imagine there are kind of people that, like, even if you didn't see them for a year, the next time you see them, it's like you pick up the conversation from the last time you saw them, like you've seen them yesterday.
Oh yeah. And I'm a super forgetful person, really bad. And people will say, like, remember this, remember that? I'm like, oh my God, that's like, oh, you know, you just go down memory lane and it's just awesome.
Did you have trouble memorizing lines and stuff?
I didn't have trouble memorizing lines. I did pretty good with that.
I cannot do that. I'm so bad at it.
Well, when you rehearse over and over and over and over and over again, it's when they change it and then you got to re-memorize something.
Was that a sort of culture shock to do a sitcom, which the mode of how that is put together is so dramatically different from a movie or a commercial, and you're basically doing like a play every week, and I imagine the pressure feels more because you do have an audience and all these things there.
Right.
Was it hard to sort of flip the skill set into working in that?
It is totally different. It's almost easier when you're on a sitcom because you have much more time to rehearse and memorize your lines. Because Mondays we do the read through.
Yep.
We'd all sit around a table. And then Monday afternoons, we would maybe block out one or two scenes. It was always an early day on Monday.
Mm-hmm.
Tuesday, we'd come back and we'd block out all the scenes. And then Wednesday, we would continue doing blocking and we would do like a run through in front of the producers. And then Thursday was camera blocking. And that was super tedious day.
Yeah.
Because it took a really long time to get through that. And then Fridays, we would tape an episode at 4 and an episode at 7.
Oh, you do the same episode, or would you do the
same episode, two different audiences? So by then, you have just drilled it into your head, all of your lines. Whereas when you do a commercial, it's so fast paced and it's like more on the fly and it's a little bit more, it's like a different kind of exciting.
Right.
And same with being on a movie set.
Right. When that show, if I'm remembering correctly, and you may not know, was built around Uecker.
Yeah.
And they just had the rights to these old Belvedere movies and kind of said, just do it with that.
I don't know how it all started, but there was old Belvedere movies and they kind of took that premise and put it in today's terms.
Because they were trying to find a vehicle for Uecker.
Yes.
Who had got a lot of heat from doing Tonight Show appearances, where he was like one of the people that they wouldn't pre-interview.
Right.
There's like four people that they don't do that for. And
right.
It's like,
he's super funny.
Yeah.
Just on the fly.
In those, were they Miller Lite commercials or whatever, the beer commercials that he was doing.
Yeah.
So they built that show around him. But was it all run by Barney Miller alumni people?
A lot of the Barney Miller people. Yeah.
Did you watch Barney Miller at all?
I knew of the show.
Right.
And I knew that that's where they were from. In fact, one of them, Tony Sheehan, went on to do King of Queens.
Mm-hmm.
And I love King of Queens.
Yeah.
That show is so funny. So, it was just, they had a lot of experience in this sitcom world.
Right.
But very different than Barney Miller.
Very different. Like, but the guy who ran Barney Miller didn't have an audience. he got the network to not do an audience after like the third episode.
Oh, wow.
And they would tape without an audience, which was nobody did at that point, and had a very different way of working.
So they just sweetened all the jokes?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
But because he would change stuff so much when they were filming, like sometimes the filming would go like 7 hours and an audience isn't going to stick around.
We had definitely had nights like that, and it would really piss people off.
My heart breaks for warm-up people because it's like, I don't have any material.
We had one guy. He was fantastic. His name was Michael Berger.
Okay.
And he was the best warm-up guy ever. And he did a phenomenal job. But yeah, there were times when it was just like, and there were times where they would just let the people go.
Because it's like a hostage situation after a while. Yes. It's like, I've been in TV.
Let my people go. Like,
can I get my jacket back? No. You're not going anywhere.
Exactly.
And it's like, you got to ask. It's like being in school. Like, you got to ask to go to the bathroom. Like, you need a hall pass. Like, you can't do anything.
Yeah.
And it's funny how I realized that later in life, because, you know, like, again, growing up so far away from it, it seems like, wow, you can just go to and just watch the taping.
Yeah.
But then people would go and be like, it's not fun.
No. I mean, it's nice having that energy there.
Right.
But yeah, after a while, it gets a little.
You're seeing the same thing over and over. Uh-huh. And then you get like resentful of why are we here? Sometimes it might be a show that you don't even know. Or like,
right.
Like, what even is this show? We just got these tickets from the concierge. It's really strange. But yeah, half the Barney Miller people went to Night Court and half, I think, went to Belvedere.
Yeah.
Which are, again, two very different shows.
Very different.
Night Court being more like Barney Miller.
Yeah.
So you said before, I think we started talking, that you didn't watch anything when you were working.
Mm-mm. Not a lot.
Right.
Movies, no.
Anything?
Uh-uh.
Wow. Just because you were so...
Just busy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just really busy working.
Were you ever starstruck by anybody? Because that might be a good way to not be, if you're not.
No, I mean, I knew who celebrities were. I remember I went to some publicity event. I don't remember what the charity was, but Mel Gibson was there.
Oh, right.
And I was just like, wow, that's Mel Gibson. And that was a big deal back then because all the Lethal Weapons were out.
Oh, yeah.
And I went up to introduce myself and he was like super nice. And I asked if I could get a picture with him and he took a picture with me. You know, they didn't have like selfies or, you know, any of that.
It might
so it was
not
like,
come out.
Somebody had like a Polaroid camera and I remember I took a Polaroid with Mel Gibson and I held on to that Polaroid with my life.
Yeah.
And, you know, after years, that photo just kind of
disintegrated.
It did. Yeah.
Well, it's like Back to the Future as his career started.
Yeah,
like
exactly.
Just his image disappeared.
Yes.
But it's funny how at that time you were a movie actor or a TV actor and if you switched, that's where you were for the rest of the career. So like you would get people like Bruce Willis who jumped out and was a movie actor and he wasn't going back to TV.
Right.
Or you'd get like older actors who like George C. Scott's coming back to TV, you know?
Right.
But you couldn't flip. And I imagine that those actors kind of ran in different circles as well. So when you see like, if you're working in TV and you see like a movie star actor,
that's a whole different ball game.
Yeah.
A whole different ball game.
Which it's not now.
Yeah.
But it even looks like Brad Pitt showed up in a ton of ABC shows, like 5 ABC shows.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, he was on Head of the Class. He was on Growing Pains twice. He was in something, I forget what the other thing was, but like, or like Clooney on Facts of Life or these things. It is kind of funny when you see them on those, and this might be a hindsight 2020 thing, but you're like, oh, they're like weird energy. Like it doesn't quite click because you're like, oh, they should be in a movie. Like not that it's saying anything disparaging the rest of the people, but there's like a different.
Well, it's like Leonardo DiCaprio on Growing Pains.
Which was after Belvedere was done?
I think it was after.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it was after.
Because there was there anyone like that who did a guest spot on Belvedere then later?
The lady that was in the Fergie.
Oh, yeah.
She guest starred on Belvedere.
Because she was on Kids Incorporated at the time and then went into Black Eyed Peas.
Yeah.
Did that ever hit you? Like when you saw her on a billboard or something, they'd be like, oh, she was a little kid on our show.
You know what? I honestly didn't realize it was her until someone pointed it out to me.
Right.
And I was like, oh, wow, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
You know?
Did you, once you got out of the industry, did you start watching stuff?
On TV?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. When I got out of the industry, I went to culinary school.
Okay.
And I worked in restaurants. And still to this day, I watch way too much Food Network.
Yeah. What sparked your interest in that?
In cooking, I've always cooked for my family. When my mom was sick, I cooked a lot for my family. So I've just always enjoyed it. So a lot of cooking shows. And like today I watched The Prophet, Shark Tank. It's kind of boring. I don't know. Yeah, I don't watch a lot of mainstream shows.
Right. Or a lot of scripted shows, it sounds like. Yeah. Mm-mm. And I know a lot of actors that's the way it is, because it's hard for them to watch them in that they're like, oh, I wouldn't have done it that way. Or like you know too much how it's made.
Yeah.
So it takes you out of it.
Right.
Whereas, when I want to just like chill out, I'm like, this old house.
I'll be honest with you. So I do watch Will and Grace.
Okay.
I absolutely love that show. The comedy timing, it's super funny. But again, that's a filmed show. It's not a taped show.
Right.
And it's funny trying to explain that to people. A lot of people don't get that.
The multicam difference versus the single cam. Yeah.
Well, you can see it with your eyes.
Oh, yeah.
It's like blatantly obvious, but some people aren't able to see it. But that's just such a great show. So if there was anything I could go back and do, it would be a show like that. Not necessarily Will and Grace, but a show that wasn't a four camera taped show.
You'd want to do like a single cam comedy or something.
That would just be so neat to do.
Yeah, it's funny how that's now the prominent vehicle for those shows.
Yes.
Like that's, whereas the multicam sitcom for 30 years was how it was. And you get a lot of people who are used to the single cam who see those shows and go, oh, that sucks. It looks weird. But I'm like, no, that's so much harder to do because you don't have the luxury of like cutaways or, using cinematic language to convey a thing. Like it's just actors and writing.
Yeah.
And to be good with that is real hard.
It is.
It's that impresses me more when I see things.
I heard this on Ellen that The Big Bang Theory.
Yep.
It's like one of the last shows that's like a four camera.
Yeah, absolutely.
Show.
Yeah.
Like one of the last.
It's definitely one of the last network shows. So a weird thing happened in like the mid 90s where the sort of traditional multicam format that like we grew up on moved to tween show, like tween things.
Mm-hmm.
So that was like Disney and Nickelodeon. Mm-hmm. So like little kids were like, oh, that's like baby shows, which is super weird because you're like, Maude and Mary Tyler Moore and Bob Newhart show aren't really like a show for 9-year-olds.
Exactly.
But that's how they like associate that with them. And so when they see a single cam show, they're like, oh, this is like a mature adult show.
Yes. Know?
So it is weird that Big Bang Theory, which I think is still like the number one show on TV, managed to, it's very traditional in that format.
It is.
And is still so successful, which is bizarre.
It is. So, I think this is our last season.
I feel like they've had a last season every season for the last 10 seasons.
No, I really think it is their last season. Yeah, I think
this actually is their last season. But it sounds like there are things that you watch that make you go, oh, I'd want to do, you get the bug again.
Yes, definitely. But not enough to stop what I'm doing now.
Right, right.
Because to go back into the industry, because I have friends that say, why don't you just go get another sitcom? Why don't you just go get an agent, go get another job? It's like, you have no clue what you're talking about. Yeah. So it's not that easy.
It's like when people tell me like, oh, you know what you should do is you should go on Conan. Like, oh, I'll just go down there.
It's like, just because you live near the studios doesn't mean the same thing.
Just go take a number and get on, Susie. Yeah.
Or all the people that say, I have an idea for a movie. Okay.
Cool. A lot of people do.
Yeah. Get in line.
Some people sell them and then nothing happens.
Exactly.
Yeah. Do you have a favorite cooking show of all time?
Oh, gosh. Oh, my gosh. I love so many different cooking shows.
It's like they shot Julia Child's show where I grew up.
Oh, wow.
In Cambridge at our PBS station. I used to see her all the time as a kid.
Are you serious?
Yeah, that was like the first celebrity I ever saw. And I was like, it's Julia Child. She drove this little, I think it was a Volvo, and she was huge. Like, just like,
she is real tall. She is really big.
You'd see her drive. And she always went to this one, which is still there. It's like a specialty meat place called Saviner's. And I'd always see her in there buying juice or something.
Was she nice and personable?
Really nice. Yeah, really nice. And because everyone would bug her. And she'd talk to everybody and was just like cool. Like she was just seemed like really chill. And, like,
that makes my day.
That's
really neat.
She was very nice. Yeah. We, for some reason, got all the PBS cooking shows shot in Boston. It's like Jacques Pepin.
I used to watch that show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I did a thing. I was a guest on some talk show for a PBS station and they wanted like comedians in the age of Trump or something. But the woman who did my makeup It was around the holidays, and I was like, oh, I just watched an old Thanksgiving Jacques Pepin special. I'm saying his name wrong. But it was him and Julia Child cooking a Thanksgiving dinner together. She's like, oh, yeah, I did makeup on that.
Oh, wow.
With brushes. I was like, oh, that's so weird. And she's like, Jacques wouldn't let a bottle of wine go to waste. So, like, if they opened a bottle of wine for cooking, he was like, we're not leaving till this has got, like, the crew, like, everybody. She's like, they never wasted a drop of wine on
that
show. That's
awesome.
So everyone was like, everyone wanted to work on that crew.
That's very cool. Did they film The Frugal Gourmet?
Yes. Yes. My dad loved The Frugal Gourmet.
I loved The Frugal Gourmet. And then I always wondered that there was a very strange, weird, you know what I'm going to say?
Oh, he got in trouble for that.
Did he really?
Yes.
Okay, so...
You weren't wrong.
So with him and the guy that his was assistant?
Yeah, yeah.
So he got in trouble. There wasn't really something going on there.
Jeff Smith got in trouble for being inappropriate.
Really?
Yeah.
Because then his show wasn't on anymore.
Right, that's why.
Interesting.
Because everyone thought that. He had like this real young assistant and everyone was like, this is a little bit weird. Maybe it's me. But no, that is, your instinct was correct there.
Times have really changed, though, because back then, it wasn't something you'd really...
You wouldn't think of that.
You wouldn't think of that.
Yeah.
Now, with the whole, like, Michael Jackson thing and everything, now it's like, it's the first thing.
But, like, yeah, even if you did think of that, you'd be like, oh, I'm terrible. You know what I mean? You'd think it was you, but you're just picking up that vibe. Yeah, my dad was so... Like, my dad loved that show and always had, like, all the books and everything.
Oh, gosh.
So I always buy him a book for Christmas every year from Frugal Gourmet because he gets really mad. It's fun.
But he's no longer, like, doing that anymore.
No. Yeah, it's been maybe 20 years. Well, part of that was, too, that's around the time Food Network started.
Yes.
And the cooking shows were only on PBS for years. You'd get, like... a segment on a show, maybe.
Right.
Like the Good Morning America has Dom DeLuise on and he's cooking, you know, homemade pasta or something like that. Well, you didn't get a whole show. And then once Food Network started, that changed everything. Yeah.
I would say my TVs in my house stay on that channel.
On Food Network?
Yeah. Food Network or the cooking channel.
Yeah. Which is like old. It's like Food Network classic.
Yeah.
I love the Reloaded Good Eats.
Oh, I love that show.
Yeah.
Yes. Alton Brown.
Yes. He's remastered all the old episodes.
Yes.
And updated them. I love that.
Did you see the episode where, okay, so for the longest time, I thought the lady that his sister, thought that was his real sister.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then to find out it's not, I was heartbroken. Yeah.
It is funny. Someone just worked television so long and be like, it's fake. Like, it's all a lie.
I know, but anybody, we should have known that.
Yeah,
but
but you want to believe it because it's that. The great thing about Good Eats is it manages to combine the best parts of something like Mr. Wizard that everybody loved growing up with sort of a sitcom because there are those characters that are very sitcom-y and a cooking show.
Yeah.
So it's like you almost... Nothing I remember was like that. It was very, very talk to the camera instructional and no history or, you know, it was like taking a cooking class.
Right.
Which that is not. They're using the language of television in a way that they weren't necessarily
doing.
It's
a brilliant idea. And then he went on and toured.
Yeah.
Which is like
a
cooking person on a tour?
Yeah.
Like you've never heard of that
before. That celebrity chef thing was...
Huge.
You never, like the 80s a little bit, probably out here with like Wolfgang Puck or like.
Right.
But that was it. There was like two people.
Yeah.
And that was more just because they had a restaurant where famous people went.
Well, one of the cool things is my kids loved Good Eats growing up in our house. And then when they went off to college, my daughter wanted me to continue to record them. So when she'd come home, she'd watch them. And then when I told her about the Reload version, I recorded those for her as well.
Would you make things from those shows?
Oh, gosh, yeah.
Because I
remember the year we did his whole... We're totally talking about cooking on this.
No.
Which is kind of fun.
This works, yeah.
The Thanksgiving episode when he made the turkey with the brine.
Yep.
I remember doing that with my kid's father. We went to Home Depot to buy things we needed.
Yeah,
like you needed the big orange bucket. Well, it didn't have to be orange, but we bought the big orange bucket and everything you needed to brine a turkey.
Yep.
And that was like a big deal.
Oh, yeah. Or like when he did the smoker out of like cardboard box.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. It's a unique... It's a little bit different now because I think people are so used to having like YouTube tutorials for everything.
Mm-hmm.
But to be able to literally watch a thing and then you can do that thing.
Yeah.
even when they do cooking segments, they never really worked in that way because it was like, I got a pen, what's happening? Oh, it's done.
Right.
You know, and they wouldn't really tell you how to do it. It'd kind of be like, so you take this stuff and then here's one we did. There you go. And that was yours. It really did. Took step by step and like it made sense. Like I still cook asparagus the way that he shows you how to cook it on that show because it's awesome.
Just stuck with you.
Yeah. And like I love America's Test Kitchen, which they do in Boston as well.
That's, oh, wow.
That one I love. And I often see the people from that show around and I get like, I'm pretty good about not getting starstruck. And for some reason, those people, I'm like, it's Bridget. she's making millionaire shortbread today or something. Like for some reason that seems in this old house too, because they shoot that in Boston. For whatever weird reason, I'm like, ooh,
that's really neat.
It's Steve Fathui's.
So it's not the has-been actresses from 80s sitcoms.
Oh, good, no, I love hearing people's stories about this stuff. So like one of the things when I started doing the show is there were so many people like I would want to read an autobiography of, mm-hmm. and they don't have one. And I'm like, I guess I'll just go get it. Because you know? Everyone has this fascinating, this is a great unifier. Like even people that were on TV, we all sort of experience and watch the same things.
Yep.
And like, even if you're part of a huge cultural phenomenon, like that, the Pepsi commercial, like you recognize that's like a huge thing. Mm-hmm. And that you still share the experience, even though it's from like a slightly different angle.
Correct.
And that's, I don't know if we're missing that now, but I always think about it, not to get like ridiculously philosophical, which I sometimes do, but people smarter than me probably should. Like pre-millennium, that shared experience of three networks, basically, kind of unified people a little bit more in that you could talk to, like I can talk to someone who's roughly in a 20-year age span of me with me about like
the same stuff.
Yeah, did you see that taxi? And we could have opposite opinions on everything.
Yeah.
And they'll be like, oh man, the one where this happened?
Yeah.
And you have that language.
Yeah.
And it's a great icebreaker and sort of you can use it as a language to convey things.
Now there is just so much.
Yeah. It's you have to
and know it changes what, every 2 seconds.
Yeah. Cause like I imagine even if you're not watching these things when you're working, you probably knew what all the shows were.
Right.
And there have been shows that have been on like CBS for 10 years and I've never even heard of it. And I'm like, really?
Yep.
And you couldn't have that. It just couldn't happen.
Yep.
Everyone
it's very
knew it.
True.
Your grandmother knew what moonlighting was, even if she never saw it.
Right.
Or, you know, so I think it's better because you have more choice, but it's still, it's not as connective, I think, mm-hmm. is the thing. And, I asked a friend of mine, I was like, what do kids have now? And she's like, oh, national tragedies. But I'm like, and that kind of makes sense. Cause like before that, it was like World War II that everyone had to like bond over.
Right.
And not like the Brady Bunch.
Yeah. Today's I think it's hard to raise kids.
I imagine
in this day and age.
That's one of the reasons I don't have any. Cause it's like, I wouldn't even know how to do it.
Yeah.
And it sounds like you did a good job, so you can go through it.
Thank you. I tried, but it's, you know, there's good days and bad days, like all parenting. But you just have to grow and change with what's happening in society.
Right.
And it's changed so much from when I was a kid.
Oh, yeah. Like, even 10 years ago.
Yeah.
It's so different.
So different.
Was there anything your kids were watching when they were growing up when you were like, what is this?
My son watched a lot of Dragon Ball Z and all those kinds of shows, and they loved all that stuff.
I went to school in England, and I worked at Cartoon Network over there, and we used to get the Dragon Ball Z episodes from Japan, and we used to have them edited, and there's a whole lot of weird stuff in there that they cut out for it in America,
which
they did not know, and it's easier to know about that stuff now with like the internet.
Yeah.
And I was like, what's in this episode? And they're like, oh yeah, we gotta cut this thing and this thing.
It's,
and I'm like, okay.
It was very interesting what they watched, very different from what I watched as a kid, but they have a much more mature taste.
How so? Like, what would be an example of?
Well, just the shows that like even kids today that are watching, it's a lot more situational, like a lot more like, you know, girls and losing their virginity or
dating. It's more frank and
absolutely.
Yeah, they don't have to deal with the trouble of reaching that right tone with a very special episode.
It can be, it's in front of your face.
Yeah, because the only show
I almost feel like parents don't have to parent anymore. You just stick them in front of the television.
A lot of them don't.
Which is really scary, yeah. But there is a lot of that.
Which I think is sometimes good because some people don't have a parent to do that with, or the ones they have aren't capable of doing it. So,
right.
But yeah, sometimes it's not like the right time or the right message, or because I don't know if you remember the show James at 15.
Yes.
That show was the first show aimed at teenagers that handled that stuff. And it wasn't an after school special, and it did it in a tone that was, not sort of talking down to teenagers, or not like an old guy writing what he thinks teenagers do. And it was revolutionary, but only lasted one season.
Right.
But people remembered it forever.
Right.
And it took till the mid 90s to start getting stuff like that again. Like,
yeah.
Like Dawson's Creek and Gilmore Girls.
Yes.
And, you know, My So-Called Life. And now that's kind of the standard.
It is absolutely the standard.
Yeah. Which, I think is probably good.
Maybe. I mean, if I watched an episode of that today, I wouldn't really know, like, is this really how it is? Because for all we know, the kids that go to high school, they might even look at those shows and go, yeah, that's not what really happens.
Oh, yeah. Or like, oh, my God.
It's a lot worse than that.
Oh, yeah. That's what I would think as
I'm
well.
Like,
yeah.
Okay, I don't want to know this.
It's all class of 1984? It's like this black jungle?
I am so glad my kids are adults now. So glad.
The sense of relief is palpable at this point.
Yes, I survived.
Do you, now that they're adults and although you seem to love what you do now in real estate, do you get more of an urge to go back? Because you're like...
To the industry?
Yeah.
Sometimes. In fact, I help in real estate. I have helped people in the industry, still in the industry, friends that are managers or agents.
Right.
And, you know, I'll even say stuff like, yeah, I miss it. You know, I sometimes wonder about going back. And they're like, don't.
Yeah.
It hasn't changed.
Right.
You're doing great. You're super successful.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Keep doing what you're doing.
Because, like, does Rob direct?
Yeah, directs documentaries.
Yeah, and then Bryce is, you know, writer-director
writing,
and
yep,
stuff. So they've shifted a little, but still kind of are in
They're
the
still
industry.
In that business.
Yeah.
I imagine it's similar.
Yeah.
They run into the same similar situations.
Yeah, which it's nice to not have to worry about.
Oops. Yeah.
It's clear. Like, I'm one of my few friends who, they're like, I thought you were doing comedy full time. And I'm like, I am. And I also work a day job, so I can say no to things. But it's like a freedom of the comfort of, you know, not that real estate can't be like a hustle because you gotta work in a similar way. But it is a slight more level of stability.
There's more stability, but also when you're in the film industry, you can't help but emote a sense of desperation if that's all that you have.
Right.
And people can pick up on that. Right. And there's a danger in that.
Yeah.
And it's hard to not give that off when you have nothing else going on in your life.
It would be like if you're like, come on, man, I really need you to buy this house.
Yeah. I know. I feel bad. Like some up and coming or hopeful actor or actress is listening to this going, man, this business sucks.
The horror stories we've heard on the show. There was a time when I would just sit people down and the first thing I would ask them be like, what horrible way did George C. Scott treat you? Because it was like every kid actor I know had like a weird run-in with George C.
Oh,
Scott.
Geez.
Where he had a friend of mine fired from a play when he was six.
Oh, no.
Because he stepped on his line or something. And
oh, my
goodness. Just like, oh, yeah. No, they've heard all the horror stories
okay,
by this
good.
Point. So, yeah, if anything, you've presented a fairly positive part
of this. It can be positive.
Did it take you a while to feel like it was positive?
Yes.
Yeah.
When I got off of Belvedere, I don't think I was prepared for how hard it was going to be to get steady work.
Right.
I think you come off of a show and everyone's going to be like, it's going to be easier.
Right.
And it wasn't. It was actually harder. And at times I would say to my agent, sometimes I wish I was just a young girl that took a bus from Kansas City and showed up wanting to start in Hollywood.
Yeah, you got no baggage and nothing.
Exactly. Exactly. So it's like you come out to LA to get a pilot. You get a pilot, gets picked up. You're grateful and fortunate to have six episodes. And then it's really hard to get work after
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it's a careful what you wish for kind of situation.
Exactly.
And it, you know, you have those people who, like we're talking about Katie, like, and she mentioned this when I had her on, the people who are on a soap, like after 3 years, if you're still there, you're like, that's what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. Like, now I'm a soap actor for the mm-hmm. rest of as long, like give up on the other stuff. This yep. is what you do.
There was an actress. She was my roommate before I bought my house. We lived together in a townhouse in Studio City. And she came down here from Texas with her mom and for pilot season. Mm-hmm. Anyway, she auditioned for General Hospital and got a role on General Hospital and was super excited and was in all the soap opera magazines. Yeah. And, you know, her ego changed and her whole demeanor changed and she was the shit.
Yep.
And then I remember coming home from Belvedere one day and she was just in tears. And I was like, what happened? And she got fired.
Yeah.
She got let go.
Mm-hmm.
And she ended up going back to Texas. And it's just, like I said, you have to ride that wave and appreciate it because it could turn on you at any moment.
Yeah. And there's a weird thing where, like, of course, if you lost that gig, you're gonna, and you can't get another gig, like, you might have to get, like, a normal job.
Right.
But people will judge you so much for that because I think people are a little savvier now. And since we don't have so many, such limited things, the profile of people isn't as large. But they are all like, oh, that person, they screwed up. Now they're working here. And it's like, yep. No, that's just, they needed to work a job. Like, it's not like that.
Right.
And it's
we
also,
get it on the industry
right,
side.
Right.
It's the people that aren't in the industry industry side that don't get it.
Which is why it's probably much easier to make that transition here.
Yeah.
Than if you went to go get it into real estate or cooking in, like, you know, somewhere in the Midwest or yeah. something like that.
Yep.
How did you get from cooking into going into real estate?
I loved cooking. I worked in restaurants for many, many years, and then I couldn't be around the food when I got pregnant with my daughter.
Oh, right.
It was just making me so sick.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I decided to be a stay-at-home mom to raise both of our kids. And then one day I saw this mom. She was a realtor. She was talking about real estate, and I thought, wow, that sounds kind of interesting.
Yeah.
Like, totally, like, now looking back, I probably was, like, the same person when I hear people going, I love HGTV. I could be a great realtor. And you're like, oh, hell no, you can't. You have no idea what like it's
this.
Like.
Yeah. Oh, you're flipping this in a day and you just paint it and then it's fine? Yeah.
So all the different personalities you deal with in the real estate industry, you really have to know how to navigate through that.
Right.
So I decided I was going to get my real estate license. And like acting, I jump in with both feet and give it my all. And here I am today, very successful real estate agent, very grateful, love helping families, and I sell real estate all over Los Angeles,
which is a really hard market.
It's very competitive,
yeah.
And you have to know what you're doing.
Yeah.
So,
well, you
got to hustle.
You need someone who knows what they're doing, and yep. like it's hard to find those people. You know, as yep. someone who's looked around and been like, oh, like we could never.
Yeah.
Do you watch any of those shows, like the HGTV shows?
I have. Like, I used to watch them when I would come home from work and my kids would be like, really? Like, why are you doing this?
You
like,
just came home from work.
Yeah, we hear you talk about real estate. Now you're going to watch real estate. I used to. Sometimes it's interesting and sometimes it just makes me laugh because it's like, you know, people buying $1 million house and they work at the grocery store.
Yeah,
like this is totally contrived.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Which is, I guess, no different than like watching Friends and being like, no, they're not in that apartment.
They're not in New York.
Oh,
right
a giant loft apartment. That's $200 a month.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah. That's a thing.
Exactly.
Do you ever, get into the history of some of the properties here? Like, cause so many of the things here have, like either like weird Hollywood stories attached to them, or like this person lived there, or they shot this there. Like, is that's a unique factor of properties out here that you wouldn't encounter other places?
It is, and I've seen it on TV shows. I haven't researched it myself, but I find it really, really interesting. Do you ever watch Million Dollar Listing?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so like a Million Dollar Listing LA, like Josh Flagg, he knows so much about history of houses in Beverly Hills, and just when they talk about that, I think, you know what, that's really cool niche to know that information
right.
is really unique. And I think about that often.
It's not necessary though.
Not necessary, yeah. but an added benefit. And I right. actually would like to educate myself more on that. Just like when you showed me where we're at today.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, saying that the place that we're in now was part of Betty Davis's estate.
Yeah.
I mean, that's amazing.
Yeah. Like to me that if I was looking at houses like out here, I'd be like, who lived here?
Right.
You know, and there used to be a place I'd stay up in the hills, and a friend of mine came over and he goes, that house was built by Howard Hughes.
Wow.
And I was like, yeah, we were looking at houses, and he built that for like one of his actresses. He'd stash in houses all over the city, but he designed this house and built it. And I'm like, you wouldn't know that.
Right.
It's a cool house, but you're like, oh, really?
That's really cool.
And that, you know, I'm not encountering that in Boston. we do sometimes have like, oh, Ben Franklin had gout there or something, like, you know, we're like, cool. Or if it's a murder house, but other than that,
oh my God.
We don't, you know, we don't have.
Aren't Ben Affleck and Matt Damon like a big deal?
Oh God. Yeah.
And like the whole Wahlberg family and.
They're
like not more than just celebrities.
Oh yeah, they're like
royalty.
Yes, because I actually do a bit about how there's like a series of things I didn't realize were weird till I started traveling outside of Boston, and it's like, you know, I realized other people don't use scratch tickets as health insurance or like that kind of stuff. But one of them is like that there are people who genuinely like the Wahlbergs and enjoy their work, because within Boston, it's like a weird love-hate thing everyone has with them.
Oh,
and
wow.
Everyone will be like, oh, the Wahlbergs. But their complaints are always like these weird personal slights.
Uh-huh.
Like I had a friend who, like, if you're like, oh, he's got a new movie out. And I'd be like, I had a party in 1997. The Wahlbergs showed up and they turned the thermostat all the way up. And we didn't notice for 3 days. I'm not seeing that movie. It's like the weirdest stuff, which you would not normally encounter.
Deep down resentments.
About like borrowed grills. You know, it's not even. And one night I used to host a weekly show at this little club in Boston. And Louis C.K., who is a monster now, but at the time we didn't know this, was filming a movie with Ricky Gervais up in Lowell, Mass. And since comedians are insane, like they'll work all day and then be like, well, I'm going to go do stand-up for free because I can't not. He would come down and do sets. And so one night he called me, and it was like a Thursday night, and he's like, hey, some friends of mine have never seen me do stand-up. Can I get a set? And I'm like, yeah. And it was Jennifer Garner and Ben Affleck.
Oh, wow.
And there was like six other people there. And they're just like sitting there, and they're dressed down, and it's weird.
That's crazy.
And they're shooting more stuff there now. So like Sandra Bullock came to a show once.
Oh, wow.
And she didn't blend in very well, definitely. She had like an entourage to like keep people away from her.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of the time it's they're just kind of on their own. And
I've been to Boston. I absolutely love it.
It's a cool
so
city.
Beautiful. But not only that, people just seem very down to earth.
There's a sort of. Yes. People, you know exactly where you stand most
yes.
of the time. And there's a lot of unique, strange things about Boston. Like I always say it's not racist. It has artisanal xenophobia. And that, because it's so provincial, people aren't like, I hate you because you're black. They're like, I hate you because you're not me. Or you don't live in my street. You know, it's more like that sort of thing.
Wow.
It's very neighborhoody.
Okay.
For better or worse. But it makes it have these very different flavors in all the neighborhoods. And we lose 30% of our population every year because they're students. So a third of the people change every year.
Oh, wow.
Which.
So it's not because of the weather. It's because they're students.
Yeah.
Interesting.
We do have snowbirds, but they're usually people who live like in the suburbs. So, but like the city itself and like the right around the city,
mm-hmm.
like in the summer, there's no one.
Wow.
And it's very strange.
There are a lot of colleges in Boston.
It's the most colleges in any like area, and it's the prominent industry. So then you also have this weird dichotomy between like blue collar, you know, Southie Boston people who are like fifth generation working there, and then like interlopers who come in and they, you know, go to Harvard. So it's a weird, but at the same time, if they didn't, we wouldn't have a job. So
wow.
It's a whole weird thing.
Interesting.
But it's super historical, and it is really mm-hmm. cool to be like. Literally, that's, you know, Ben Franklin used to sit there, you know,
yeah.
JFK used to go there. And
it's so full of history.
Yeah, you don't get that most of the country.
That's true.
Like, I remember going to Texas and they're like, this is the oldest thing here. It's from 1972.
And you're like, that's
like,
it?
I'm like, really? And they're like, yeah, and we're tearing it down and make a new one. But here you have that, even though it's a more modern history. But,
right.
But most of Los Angeles was founded by Boston people.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, like if you go downtown, like Bunker Hill is named after Bunker Hill in Charlestown, Mass. And like Beverly Hills is named after Beverly, Mass. And Melrose, Mass. And it was like D.W. Griffith and all those people were all Boston people.
Oh, wow.
They all came out here. And
interesting.
Yeah, we're like, yeah, we could do this.
Interesting.
Well, it's been great talking to you. Thank you so much for doing
you
this.
You too. Thank you. I had so much fun.
Oh, great.
Yes.
There you go. That's Tracy. I cannot thank her enough for taking the time to chat with me. That was a huge deal for me. That was very, very fun. You know, doing this show for almost 6 years now, I still can't believe that I'm still surprised, shocked, and amazed that people speak to me at all, let alone people that I have been dying to talk to for years. So that was fantastic. Hopefully you agree. If you have guest requests that you would like to have me try to get on the show, or people you know that you would like to put in touch with me to do the show, please email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or ken@icanread.com. Also, we're on the social media. Just search TV Guidance Counselor Ken Reed Comedy on Facebook. I am at TV Guidance on Instagram and Twitter. I am at Kenneth Conoth. What was that about? Kenneth W. Reed, R-E-I-D, on both. I am not on Snapchat. I don't understand it. I assume it's some kind of sex thing, and it makes me nervous. But if I should be on that, let me know. Anyway, we have a brand new episode next week, so please come back. And we'll see you again next time on a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.